Hello and welcome back to this Superliminal Films, Superliminal Games, MTG Arena Pauper Primer, Core 2020 edition. That is a lot of words. My name is Dan, and I'm joined as usually by Max. Say hello, Max.
Hello.
So we're here to talk to you about what has changed since War of the Spark Pauper, and what we think has been added to the format, what may or may not still be viable in the format from before, and just exactly how Free Pauper is going to work for you, we think. And given that we've been pretty damn spot on so far, I think we'll be pretty all right for this one as well.
Yeah, we have a good track record.
We do. We've predicted a lot of correct stuff.
Yeah. We're correct some of the time.
Yeah, we've definitely had good success ourselves. Not that you can necessarily have like a ton of success in this, because there isn't a ton up for offer.
Right.
But you can have a lot of success with this, because especially now that once again it's free, and if you're the kind of person that wants to just get your basic land and you know, get your six wins as quickly as possible, or at least get your one win to get your 1,000 mastery experience, tune in.
Yeah,
we aren't sure if this is going to be this weekend or next weekend as this video goes live, but it's going to be one of the two.
Yeah, and we'll have deck lists below in the description that you can check out, and we'll run them through Aether Hub like we always do, so you can put them right into your machine and have deck.
Easily export directly into the program.
And hopefully you've listened long enough to hear me say that, and don't drop in the comments, deck list?
I mean, people are going to drop in the comments, deck list, question mark, anyway, but...
I know. You out there, talking to you.
Talking to you.
So I think the rundown's going to be, we're going to go over the cards in general that are standouts from the core set that we got this time, and then we will kind of bop into deck lists that we think, historically, the meta has generally kind of been built around, and some things we think that you can do to take advantage of all of that good stuff. So
that gooey good stuff.
The gooey good stuff, GG's. So we got lands up first, and it's a real treat, actually, this section of
land. We get real Pauper lands.
Yes, these are the actual factual lands that you play in Pauper.
In now called Unified Pauper,
I guess. Yeah, the newest Pauper. I mean, even the older Pauper since, what were these, Cons of Tarkir, when these boys came out, I believe?
Yes.
So yes. We have all these duels here, if you will. They come into play tapped, but they gain you one life. So they're a strict upgrade to the previous Guild Gates and the other core
tapped
set lands.
Non-life gaining lands.
Yeah, the ones we had previously. So this is a really big boon for a lot of two-color decks in the format. And that's really kind of all I need to say about that. They're good. They're quite good. They're played in actual Pauper.
Yeah, I mean, really, that's... Like, they're played in Unified Pauper, you should play them in Arena Pauper. If you have access to a card that's played in that format, you should almost always play it in this one, pretty much 100% of the time.
Yeah, I think that's pretty fair. And they're not flashy, but one life can be the difference between winning and losing a game.
Mm-hmm.
So now we're on to artifacts, and there's nothing in this section that really intrigues me too much outside of Heart Piercer Bow could possibly be a thing. I don't know what deck wants Heart Piercer Bow.
Sadly, what the deck that wants Heart Piercer Bow is a deck that's trying to get multiples of them on the table and fight against a menace that isn't in the format anymore in Persistent Petitioners.
Right. I mean,
that's an answer for three of these is an answer for that pretty quick cleanly.
Yeah, and I mean, you have the ability to wipe the board of small things. Rats obviously are a thing, and they're always a thing because the first thing people who aren't really interested in Pauper want to do is just jam, you know what I mean, rats into a deck. 20 lands, 40 rats, we're ready to rock. And you all know my opinions on that from the last video, so I won't go there. But I don't see much else really being super useful out of the artifacts that we get here. So We'll move on to green, our first actual factual color with spells in it. And I'm just going to point out some of the cards I think are kind of cool and or impactful to the format that maybe we haven't had before that might do something. So
please,
a couple things that look kind of good. Leafkin Druid being one of them. It's a tapper for mana, and we already have a 1/3 that taps for mana from, you know, the core set and previously Kaladesh, and that card's quite good. This has no power, but it can tap for 2 mana if you're doing something where you're dropping a bunch of smaller creatures with your mana instead of a going tall payoff. So that is potentially quite good. We get Rabid Bite back, which is quite good as well. I think it is a powerful removal spell and plays in really well with Sedge Scorpion, who we get back.
I was just going to say, Sedge Scorpion is absolutely great at things that fight or bully.
Yeah, I think that card is quite good with the 1/1 death touch there. I think possibly Ferocious Pup could be a thing because it's two creatures in one. It's a little weird. It's not as good of a card as like a Yavimaya Sapherd, but it's still pretty interesting. And if there's any kind of Aristocrats deck, these 2-for-1 creatures are really, really good. Netcasters. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I think similarly, if there's any kind of Aristocrats build, your Silverback Shaman is going to be a good curve topper for that because it's a big beater. And if you have to sacrifice it, it draws a card.
Yes. So I was going to get to Silverback. He is excellent. I think full stop, a really good card.
He replaces himself when he dies. Yeah.
He's not ridiculously expensive, so you can play him in a non-dedicated ramp deck. Obviously, quite good hitting the battlefield about a turn or two early before most of the good beaters. The one with Riot comes to mind, Wrecking Beast, I think it's called. And you also have, obviously, Siege Worm both coming in at 7. 6 is the Great Maul, or whatever it's called, the 6-6.
Hey, Maul!
Yeah, get off the dang roof. I think this is coming in a turn before those is really good for a beater curve. So that's all pretty good.
Being able to curve Silverback Shaman into Dreadmom into Vorstclaw just seems like there's your 5, 6, 7.
Or Wrecking Beast even better because the boy's got haste.
Yeah, true.
That boy gets played in Real Pauper and Reanimator.
Yeah, true, Wrecking Beast.
Brightwood Tracker, I think, is a possibility. It's quite slow, but
That's an expensive ability, dude.
It is, and we'll get to... I do have a deck with one copy of Brightwood Tracker in it, and I will show you that when we get to the deck-building portion. Outside of that, that's kind of our green commons. Like, Thicket Crasher's not bad, meaty, part of the curve. There is one hidden card, if you will. It's not in the set. It came out either on Arena proper or in, like, an ancillary release, like the Planeswalker decks or something. That's pretty sick, and I don't think a lot of people are going to be up on, is Prized Unicorn. Prized Unicorn is a 2/2 for 3 and a green. You can see it on the screen. And all creatures able to block Prized Unicorn do so.
Good old lure.
So, yeah, if in a combat situation where you're like, man, I have like these big mid-rangey creatures and I just can't get them through, Prized Unicorn goes, don't worry, I got you. And makes every creature tangle with Prized Unicorn and the rest of your guys get through. So... Prized Unicorn is quite powerful, and I think quite a card that's going to go unnoticed. The little hidden treasure. So let's move over to red. So in red, we have quite a plethora of things that are kind of cool. One of them is Infuriate. It's like a giant growth, but one less toughness for a single red. It is an instant. I think that card's quite good for the beater strategies that are just trying to kill you real fast. Another one I think is a good addition to that beater style strategy is Scorch Spitter. One for one. And it attacks
extra damage.
Yeah, it attacks for extra damage, which is pretty sweet. We get Shock. Obviously, that's not new. Chandra's Embercat. I don't know if there's a payoff for elementals at common per se. I don't think there's anything that's like overly spectacular for being dedicated creature type. But if you find a couple elementals you're looking to cast, Chandra's Embercat can definitely be that creature.
Yeah, I mean, so here's the thing about your elementals, right? You mentioned Scorch Spitter already. We have Lavakin Brawler, Wildfire Elemental, Chandra's Embercat, and that's just in red.
Correct.
If we poke up to green, we do also get Thicket Crasher and the aforementioned and Leafkin Druid.
Yes.
And Healer of the Glade. So you've got 2-1 drops, multiple 2 drops. You can really bit bop around.
You can.
And I think that's potentially playable. I didn't think to pull up a search string for this, but I think I'm going to real quickly while we're at it, because I think Red Green Elementals is playable.
Yeah, well, let me talk about a card while you're looking that I think is quite the little key interaction. If you played a lot of Core 2020 Limited, you've probably seen this interaction, and this is a card called Goblin Smuggler. It's a 2-2 for 3 with haste, and it has a tap ability. Another target creature with power 2 or less can't be blocked this turn. So the little trick is you give the Lavakin Brawler that Dan was mentioning. I'll move over to that now. You give that unblockable, then you attack with it, and it gets its +1/+0 trigger for each elemental you control. And now all of a sudden you're swinging like a 7/4 unblockable at your opponent. And unless they can kill it, they are certainly not blocking it. So it's good.
Other things that are elementals, Catalyst Elemental.
Mm-hmm.
Fire Shrine Keeper, which we've gone into great detail about in previous iterations of these primers, when you had to fight petitioners by being fast and pantsy.
Yes.
And those are pretty much the ones of note. Gaea's Protector is an elemental, which is another lure.
Is Bloomhulk an elemental?
That costs 4. Yes, Bloomhulk is also an elemental. So there are 14 commons in red and green that have the creature type elemental currently legal in standard. So I'm not saying it's necessarily going to work because one of those is Fire Urchin. But when you consider that we have removal and Embercat, which ramps, and some powerful creatures, I'm not saying it's not going to work.
Yeah. And I think the only other spell that Red really gets that's like kind of cool, and Dan touched on it earlier when he's naming off elementals, is Wildfire Elemental. Another one of the, like, it's not really in the set cards.
Yeah, I think it's from the Planeswalker deck because it's a card I had to pick up for the Pauper Cube, and I was upset I couldn't get in foil because it doesn't exist in foil.
Yeah, it's a 3/3 for 4, and whenever an opponent is dealt non-combat damage, creatures you control get +1/+0. So
yeah, go ahead, shock your opponent and give your team +1/+0.
Yeah, the rare lure effect, or even works great with Chandra's Outrage.
Yep, Chandra's Outrage, which is a card that we get now again in this format, which is great. Scorch Spitter, like, have 2 Scorch Spitters on the battlefield and attack, and your whole team's getting 2-0.
Yeah, it becomes pretty bonkers. I don't know if you can run more than a couple of them, but it is quite good. So flipping over to black, some cards that I think are kind of spicy. We have Bone Splinters, not really anything great because we have a better card, More of the Spark, for that. But we do have Hidden Treasure Disentomb, which is really sweet. It's so cheap. Don't discredit Disentomb's ability to be really good because it lets you double spell much faster than the reanimation spells we've gotten typically and up to this point in the format.
Single black is extremely powerful.
Yep, we have Sanitarium Skeleton, who can do some work in longer games, to be sure.
Yeah, and haven't seen him in this format, so I'm interested to see what people do with him. I personally think you're glossing over the Downshift of Murder to be playable in the format.
I haven't got
that.
That's
the first thing I would have said.
I'm going by mana cost.
I know Arena goes by mana cost, and I'm going by by name, but I still murder.
Yeah, murder is. I mean, 3 costs is a little high, and if you're in a black heavy deck, I think murder's possibly the way to go. I still don't know if it's better than Obnixilis's Cruelty, but it is quite the player for sure, and more removal is never a bad thing. Blood Burglar, I think, is another one to keep an eye on. It's got lifelink on your turn. It could be good in the life gain strategies, especially if you're going for a little bit lower end version of that.
I think Burglar is definitely playable.
Sorcerer of the Fang, decent stats. It's a good blocker, and late game it could end up being something. I don't know as though
If you can chew up like the ground game or shore up your ground game pretty well and just like remove all their stuff, you know, Sorin's Thirst their small creatures, murder their big creatures, and just, you know, have like a mono black control kind of bent between that and, but I guess the question is that or Vampire Opportunist.
Right.
Is the extra mana of Vampire Opportunist just better because you don't have to tap? So if you get to 14 mana, which you're not going to get to, but you gain life off that.
It's a good question. So let us know in the comments if you're leaning towards one direction or another. Audacious Thief, I think, is a big deal. I think it's maybe one of the most important black cards in this set. Whenever it attacks, you get to draw a card and lose a life. He can come down pretty quick. He can start attacking. He is a little slow in Pauper, but if you can take advantage of him and get more than... I mean, because right now, like, kind of our lean-to card for deck lubrication in black is good old Dusk Legion Zealot.
Dusky Z!
And Audacious Thief, if you can clear the way for him, he can hit, if he hits twice, he's a better rate than Dusk Legion Zealot is. So, definitely worth keeping an eye on. Gorging Vulture, if you're looking to throw cards in the bin, is quite a good card. It'll gain you a little bit of life. It's a flyer, and it's pretty cheap. And, you know, kind of just does everything. Real basic card, but a good card for sure.
Yeah. The plays well with Undead Servant.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. A lot of things. It's just, it synergizes really nicely. We have the aforementioned Murder. Great card. We have Savage Gorger is an interesting one. It's a three mana, 1/1 flyer. At the beginning of your end step, and if opponent lost life this turn, put a 1/1 counter on it. Really spicy. Yeah. Agonizing Siphon, I think, is a good, like, one or two of in your life gain decks. 3 damage to any target and gain 3 life.
Plus great Submechanon Art. Also, yes. Savage Gorger is another not actually in the set, card.
Yep.
Because I was like, why haven't I seen this card in Limited? Well, yeah. It's because it's number 291 out of 280.
That's right. So, yeah, I think Siphon's pretty good. We've had the Fathom Fleet Cutthroat. He's okay. Same with Skeleton Archer, who's another hidden card in the set. You also have, in addition to Undead Servant, Boneclad Necromancer, who's a little expensive, but can exile creatures from the yard if that's relevant, and also brings along a zombie buddy. Not too bad.
Mm-hmm.
Moving into blue, we have Fairy Miscreant. I think this card is pretty good, and another card that has played an actual factual Pauper. Mm-hmm. So certainly one to keep an eye on. Obviously, we don't have Ninja of the Deep Hours in online arena yet for Pauper. Hopefully not, because that card's very, very good. And the Miscreant, just, it's a lot of value, especially if you can do something to gate it or bounce it back to your hand in some way. Even if you can't, it's a little beater. You can hook things on it if you're going for, like, an aura-style beatdown, and it just gives you value because the second, third, and fourth one hopefully all replace themselves.
I think there's a blue-white, like, Flying Pants deck because we got Metropolis Sprite and Cloud Conceer in this set as well.
Yeah, I think there definitely will be some experimentation there.
And we got Winged Words, and so, like, blue-white Flyers... Con Pants seemed pretty good.
Yep. Unsummon in the set, not negligible. We had Unsummon for a little while back when Amonkhet was around, and what's back. And don't underestimate Unsummon. That's all I have to say about that.
I agree.
Metropolis Sprite, as Dan brought up, quite the efficient flyer. It lets you sink your mana in odd costs and, like, weird turns where you have 1 or 2 mana up. You have a home for using it. If you make this card bigger, you can activate the ability more times. That is definitely worth noting. So make sure you're keeping an eye on that as well. For newer cards, I think the standout in the color... There are two cards that are standout in blue in this this particular core set for me. And one of them is Cloudkin Seer. It's a 2/1 flyer for 3. When it ETBs, you draw a card.
Card just busted in half.
It's very, very good.
Card's just busted in half.
Yeah, it's very good. Nothing really else to say about that. It's also an elemental. Good point of note there. Frostlynx, solid, good tempo card. We had a Merfolk version of it already, but getting Frostlynx here, also an elemental, again, worth noting. We have Sage's Road Denizen, which is a card that sees fringe play in Pauper, actual Pauper, or sees play in the Familiars deck as a way to win by milling your opponent out. I wouldn't be surprised to see somebody playing a goofy version of a Denizen deck. My advice is just make sure you have protection for your Denizens. Pretty straightforward. Make sure you can dive down or spell pierce or something to protect them.
Mm-hmm.
Winged Words is the other contender for best common, I think, out of blue. And maybe one of, like, this and the Cloud Conceer feel like amongst the top commons, full stop for the set. Winged Words costs 2 and a blue. Unless you have a flyer, then it costs 1 and a blue, and it draws you 2 cards. Bonkers. If you can get this off for 2, like, if you Fairy Miscreant on 1 and then Winged Words on 2, attack with your fairy, you are way you feel ahead.
Like a genius. Yeah. Yeah, and you feel like a genius.
It's real good. Bone to Ash got a downgrade to common for us, so it can counter a spell and draw a card if you're playing the very, very slow decks. Celestial Messenger is an interesting one. It's a 3-2 flash flyer, and it gets +1/+1 if you control a Yangling Planeswalker, which isn't going to happen in common, but it is a 3-2 flash flyer, so be cognizant of that.
Yeah, it has big.
Yeah. And outside of that, you know, we have Octoprophet, who's interesting, but probably not a role player, and Boreal Elemental is possible if you're really going hard at Elementals. So I think.
Yeah, I mean, I would probably give Boreal Elemental the edge over several other things, so.
Yeah, I mean, anything to help defend itself is pretty darn good.
Yeah, I agree.
White is the next stop. There's not too much to talk about in white. It didn't get a ton of things. It got a couple things that are pretty good. One of them, I think, is Angelic Gift. Angelic Gift, I think, is a kind of crummy enchantment. It does draw a card, and it gives the creature flying. So if you're going to play, if you were playing formerly like three color auras, I think you can cut it down to two because of Angelic Gift. It's another way to give evasion without having to play blue for it in your enchantments, which I think is important.
Mm-hmm.
Outside of that, we have Pacifism, which I think is quite good and not something we had access to before. It's got weird art, but it is quite a good card. It's very cheap and does very well. I think the big card that the set got gave us was Raise the Alarm.
Heck yeah.
For the tokens, before that, really, our cheapest token producers were like an Unkick Sapperling Migration, and then we had like a Queen's Commission for vampire tokens. This is cheaper and an instant, so it is quite good, I think. If they're going to try to do something to destroy a couple tokens, you can hold up mana and charge to protect them, or now you can, if they don't do that, you can end a turn, Raise the Alarm to add to your board. I think it's very solid, very cheap. It does kind of everything you want to do.
Plus, we have payoff in Inspiring Captain into
Inspired Charge.
Make a bunch of tokens, Inspiring Captain, Inspired Charge, and what the hell is the angel?
Dawning Angel.
The angel that does the Inspiring Captain thing?
Isn't it Dawning Angel? Oh, no, that's this one. Whatever it's called.
Yeah, the other 5-drop angel that gives +1/+1 from the previous sets.
Yeah.
What was it, from M19?
Yep. Is Angel of the Dawn?
Like very much. It might be Angel of the Dawn. I know that's a magic card.
Cool.
We clearly did our research.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's...
It is, in fact, Angel of the Dawn.
Well, there you go. So they're
yes,
close to Dawning Angel.
True. But being able to like make a bunch of tokens into Inspiring Captain one turn into Angel of the Dawn the next turn, that's just a ton of damage.
Yeah.
And it's a lot of damage out of nowhere as well.
Yep. So I just want to touch on the decks, and I'm going to keep this pretty darn brief because you'll be able to access all the deck lists at the bottom. And if you're still watching, hey, thanks for watching still. I have a couple decks that I think are pretty good historically. There's one deck that's kind of an experimentation. We'll hit that one up last. Pauper Is It Aggro, Pauper Big Is It, both of which are decks that are looking to exploit tempo-based strategy of killing your opponent's creatures with cheap spells, burning them if need be, and getting in with your little tiny creatures that hopefully are decent. The Big Is It deck features the Spell Gorger Weird, I think is the red one, and whenever they cast a non-creature spell, it's a 1/1 counter. That card is a freaking tank. So... Uh-huh. That card is... I prefer the Big Is It deck over the Is It Aggro deck. Then we have Pauper IGI, Ill-Gotten Inheritance. And I added white to this. I'll go ahead and pull this one up because this one did get a pretty big boost. I felt like Scoured Barrens was a nice piece to have with the life gain to trigger off of Epicure of Blood. And I think it was a nice addition. I also got I only added a couple things in white with the splash because it's relatively free. I added Revitalize, which is gain 3 life and draw a card. It just lets you cycle, gain a little bit of life. This deck has, like I said, the Epicure as a payoff for that. And the deck's trying to go really far over the top by gaining life. And you also get what I'm playing is a Miser's Copy of Blessed Light. Because I think being able to answer other IGIs or other troublesome enchantments would behoove you. Especially, like I said, we talked about the Aura-style deck already. Having just a kind of... It's not like you're going to win the game off this, but this may slow it down enough. And you're going to draw a lot of cards with this particular deck. Because you're playing the Revitalize. You're playing the Dusk Legion Zealot. You're just taking a lot of turns because this is a slow deck. So be aware of that. But it is consistent. It was one of our best performers in the last Pauper event. So don't discredit it as some like slow nonsense deck. It has actually got some game.
It's good.
From there, we have Mono Red, which plays a lot like the two Izzet decks, where we're trying to burn things out, take advantage of triggers from playing spells, and, you know what I mean, kind of do red stuff from there. Nothing too crazy.
Do red stuff.
Pauper Mono Blue is one I'll highlight because it did get some cards from the new set. It got Fairy Miscreants. It also got Metropolis Sprites. And it also got Cloudkin Seers. And it also got Winged Words. So it has a lot going on.
Blue got in the air.
Blue gets all kinds of advantage. It feels like this deck's pretty good about keeping a number of threats in its hand to keep coming at you. And it also has Secret Wing Condition of Giant Amass Token with the Avon Eternal and the Callous Dismissal. So don't discredit this deck's ability to put like a 4-4 on the ground that the opponent just can't deal with because they're all hung up on dealing with all your tiny flyers. So... That's a pretty interesting one, I think. I'm excited to try out. And historically, those like evasive low-end tiny threats were already pretty good, and giving them all evasion is very, very good. The Dimir Control deck, you'll be able to see the list. It didn't get much. It got that. I put in a singleton of the Flash Flyer because I think it's quite good. And I put in, obviously, the Life Gain Land because it's quite good. The Tokens deck, I put in Raise the Alarm. And I fiddled with some numbers a bit just to make everything smoothed out. But yeah, it mostly got Raised the Alarm. And the Spicy deck I'm interested to try out that people always try out and we make fun of kind of to no end when we play against it, but I think may have some game this time, is Mono Green Ramp. So normally we poke fun of this deck because it's just like, okay, cool, you got a threat down and you're dead now. I think this deck has some good flexibility now for a couple of reasons. Arboreal Grazer helps you get mana down, and it blocks flyers as an 0-3. It actually is pretty good size in this format. Land of War Elf, obviously, for ramp. Adventurous Impulse for card advantage. Druid of the Cowl is the 1-3 I mentioned earlier on to add mana. I put Sorrowform Hybrid in as a mana dump. We can put down a blocker early against the aggro decks. And it turns into a very big creature later on because we can just keep dumping 6 into it to make it bigger and bigger.
All of these statements are true.
I also have this Ursine Champion from M19, which is one of the hidden M19 cards. It's pay 6, and it gives it +3/+3 and becomes a Bear Berserker. You can only activate the ability once a turn, but it gives you a consistent 5/5 attacker every turn. And also, just a bear, the old 2/2 for 2. One of the payoffs here, again, to sink our mana is Vivian's Grizzly, and that card's great. If you play War of the Spark, you know how powerful this card can be. And in a deck that's literally all creatures, it's real.
I've actually considered adding Vivian's Grizzly to my Pauper Elves deck in Unified Pauper.
It's pretty good. I know people were testing it out of the gate because it's just, again, such a good mana dump. Mm-hmm. And speaking of mana dumps, I have my Singleton Brightwood Tracker in this particular deck, mostly because the 2/4 is pretty relevant in this format. That 4-butt will block a lot of significant creatures. So you can get, you know, your other little bears hopefully will do the job for the most part. But this is a good flexible mix. I already have, I'm maxed out on Vivian's Grizzlies, and I'm maxed out on Sorrowform Hybrids and the Ursine Champions. So this is just another good mana dump if I really need it.
Mm-hmm.
And then for the payoffs to all this ramping, we have 4 Silverback Shaman, which we talked about earlier being great on the curve. And I mean... 2 Dreadmaw and 4 Wrecking Beast. So
heck yes.
We go 5, 6, 7 in this deck. And if I need to, I haven't fiddled with this, so feel free to take this as a foundation and fiddle with numbers. Like, I could definitely see dropping an Arboreal Grazer, going up a Dreadmaw, something along those lines. Maybe just dropping the tracker if it ends up underperforming and putting in another one of the big payoffs, or another going up to the full 4 Adventurous Impulse to help sort out your draws and make sure you get your payoffs when you need them and your ramp when you need them.
And so, the great part about this is the event's free, so you can test as much as you'd like.
Yeah, so I mean, that's kind of what I'm looking to try out. And, you know, obviously I usually build 1 or 2 during the time the event's running as well, just because I like the format. But if you're looking to get a leg up, here's some deck ideas. If you want my particular opinion on a deck I should pick to win, if you're patient, the Dimir deck and the IGI were easily the most consistent decks we've built. especially yes. the Dimir control deck is just every time we've played it, it's been awesome. But you're gonna have slightly longer game times. If you're trying to end the game quickly, I would recommend leaning towards like the mono red deck or the tokens deck. I have the untested decks I have are the mono green and the mono blue, so I have no clue if those are really good, but I suspect that they'll both be okay. So we'll find out. And I can tell you that, the Pauper Big Izzet deck is definitely better than the Izzet aggro deck. So that's my takeaway from this being historic. You know, historically, we have a bunch of choices, and I think we have some good new kids on the block as well.
I have exactly one question for you regarding new kids on the block.
Sure.
Do we have enough goblins yet?
I just think we're still lacking the... What's the payoff for playing all these goblins? You know what I mean? I think there are more than enough goblins across the curve that really help, and I think Goblin Smuggler is sweet, and I think we definitely have some cool goblin weapons. I just think I don't know if we'll ever get, like, goblin... I mean, what made goblins good in Real Pauper? Goblin Grenade. I just don't know if we have... Or, like, Goblin Sledder or something like that that really lets us... Something a goblin, right? You need that goblin, that heavy goblin synergy. But goblins are very commonplace in fairy tales, so maybe Eldraine will bring something to the table for gobos.
I want to know what an Eldraine goblin, just based on what I've seen out of Throne of Eldraine, so that's very exciting.
Yeah, but, I mean, that's my take on the situation for Pauper. As always, please, please, please leave your comments below about your takes, because, man, we always get some great recommendations about what people are winning with, or some spicy stuff that they're looking into, or perhaps some cards that we overlooked that end up being great. Tamiyo's Epiphany was one that ended up really being a standout for the Dimir deck that I totally overlooked. And it ended
up being a boss. What should we be playing with? What did we fuck up?
Yeah.
Where did we stick our foot in our mouths?
Let us know.
Yeah, let us know. And if you like what you're hearing here, seeing here, www.superliminalfilms.com is where you can find everything that we do on the internet. We can also be found on Facebook, Twitter, Twitch, and Instagram, as well as right here on YouTube, producing magic content and other stuff every single week of the year, multiple days of the week across podcasts, streams, videos, and I don't know, whatever else we're into at the moment. Bye, everybody.
Bye.